Jamie Dixon, as you just heard, and I'm going to talk a little bit about computers, visual effects, and movies, and maybe, if we're lucky, the magic of movies. How did I get here? This is a little bit of an interesting story. I was flying to Pittsburgh a couple of years ago to work on a movie called Concussion. It was about the effects of concussions in the NFL, starring Will Smith. And my seatmate was doing some computational fluid dynamic simulations of jet contrails. And I'm probably making some of this up, but as they related to climate studies. And one of the things that we discussed was the effects of how detailed the simulations that he was running were, had to be. And it was, he was finding that they had to be, it had to be quite detailed to really pertain, you know, to participate in the calculations properly. And then, so I created this, which is actually my simulation of his simulation. I don't know if you can see, I have the low res ones here and the high res, and hopefully that's something that he was talking about. Anyhow, we had a great discussion. Thank you very much. See you later. Have good luck with your work. About 18 months later, I got this email, and it said, how do you like to be a speaker at the Argonne training program? And I'm like, oh my God. It reminded me of one of the very first emails I ever got, first junk email. It said, how would you like to be called Reverend Dixon? And I'm like, and then I read further, and it says, oh, wait a minute. This is not so unusual after all. And by the way, that guy you were sitting with on the plane was my husband, and it was from MARTA. So here you go. It's funny how those things work out, but here we are. Okay, a little background. I grew up in Berkeley, California. Both of my parents were PhD scientists. And my dad actually worked here in Chicago in the 40s. He was at the University of Chicago, and he was working in Glenn Seaborg's metallurgical laboratory on the Manhattan Project, purifying plutonium. And he went on to work at Los Alamos and eventually became an organic chemist at Berkeley, working on sequencing human growth hormone. My mother has an amoeba named after her. There's a kind of a crazy distinction, and she still has a lab. Actually, she's 90 years old, and she still has a lab at the California Department of Health, and she studies the effect of amoeba, and in particular, she's fascinated by these ones that cause meningitis, and unfortunately, a disease, luckily it's not very common, but almost always fatal. Much to their dismay, maybe not their dismay, I'm not sure, but I was never a great, I wasn't really academically, I wasn't so, you know, so interested in academics. I was interested in herpetology, and this is one of my little friends here in slow motion. I also like shooting a lot of things. When I was a kid, I was into creature features and ViewMasters and Stereopticons, making Super 8 movies, Fabulous Thunderbirds, Thunderbirds Are Go. I also really loved how you could sit in a movie theater and people would get so emotionally wrapped up and scared and screaming and, oh, I don't want to see that. And I realized that movies literally were a piece of plastic running in front of a light bulb. And it was really kind of interesting to me how that little configuration could cause something that was so that made so much, had such an impact on people's you know, emotions, really, at the time. I was also starting to get fascinated with how much work it took to get that image on the piece of plastic that was running in front of the light bulb. You had to basically go do those things, and ultimately, computers would give us the tools that we could create things that looked like they happened, but they didn't actually have to happen. So that was some of the early days. Okay, so when I started, it's funny, whenever we talk about the olden days, it always seems like everything seems so primitive. It's like, oh my God, how could you have done that in 4K of RAM? That's impossible. You couldn't use that. But at the time, 4K of RAM was a lot more than no K of RAM. And then you know, when we got a gigabyte hard disk and going forward, it always felt so futuristic. And you know, now with hindsight, of course, that's not the case. But I also used glowing orbs for this slide because a producer that I worked with was so mystified about the process that we did to do our work that we kept teasing her. It's like, what do you think we're using, glowing orbs? And anyhow. The first computer I worked on was that I was ever exposed to. I was in seventh grade, and we had a teletype connected with a, you know, this is one of those modems where you literally put the handset in the speaker in the microphone, and it was connected to a, I'm not even sure what kind of computer it was, up at the Lawrence Hall of Science. And we did groundbreaking work on this. Of course, I was in seventh grade. We printed Snoopy calendars. And it was, remember, we're going, looking forward. This was amazing. There was no Snoopy calendars before this, and now we could. Anyhow, I got exposed to programming in BASIC and all of that kind of thing. My next computer experience wasn't until about 10 years later. I was a student in computer science at Cal Berkeley, and we had a PDP 1144. I think there was probably five or six of those, a couple of 1170s. There was a DEC 10 that we learned to program by toggling registers on the front panel, all that kind of thing. And the way we would talk to those was with a good old-fashioned Lear-Siegler ADM3A, and we were taught Pascal, and there was actually two tracks. If you were in the science track, you could take Fortran, or if you were doing computer science, you would take Pascal and theoretically learning structured programming. And to do our assignments, obviously we had to log into the computer, and there was a lot of other people trying to use these limited resources. So a lot of times we'd have to go in at 2 o'clock in the morning. I'd have to go in at 2 o'clock in the morning to find an open terminal. And if you were lucky, there'd only be 40 people that were plugged into that one 1144 at that time. Around the same time, I got my first personal computer. This was a very advanced 1 megahertz 6502, 8K BASIC in ROM, 4K RAM, single board computer made by Ohio Scientific called the Superboard 2. I would save programs on this. It had a thing they called a Kansas City Standard interface, which basically would play out a modem signal that you could record on a cassette tape, and you would list your program, and it would remember it and play it back into the thing. The visual interface to this was a 25 by 40 character display that just played on your television set. The computer was $350 or so, was around the price range that came in at. Really awesome thing. At 2 o'clock in the morning, there was only one user, and that was me. And so this was really my first kind of opportunity to start playing with the machines and figuring out what we could push them to do. While I was at Cal, I got really kind of exposed for the first time to computer graphics, and we had access to a Tektronix 4014 vector drawing terminal, and this terminal literally had two commands. It had a move to and a line to, and so we wrote Pascal software that we wrote programs in Pascal that would do three-dimensional camera transformations, converting from three-dimensional to the two-dimensional screen space. Modeling was done on a piece of graph paper, and we literally would write the coordinates down, and we'd put those into our program. So, and what I was doing with that is kind of back to those early interests. I was printing out two images with a slightly different camera position, and guess what? You have a stereo 3D image. And I put it into an old stereopticon from the 1900s, and all of a sudden we could see three-dimensional versions of these simple models that we were making. And for animation, there was a little line that you could tap into on the back of that thing, and if you sent the terminal a print command, it would drop the voltage, and we built a little circuitry that effectively would engage a solenoid and push the cable release on a Super 8 movie camera. So we're off to the we're able to make a simple animation of these. This would have been around 1980, certainly not the first, but definitely early computer graphics. The next system I got was a significantly more sophisticated system at that point. It was still a microcomputer that used a Z80 processor, and it had the CPM operating system. I was programming this in BASIC now, and I had a terminal that connected to that that had a lot of, this thing basically had a lot of more high-level commands. So it was handling things like camera transformations and all that kind of, all of that more sophisticated stuff. And so I could focus on having the program, make nice-looking images, and it would, and I figured out a way that if I just kind of ran stuff into it as fast as possible, it basically looked like animation. It was still limited to wireframes, but now they were in color and some advantages like that. I would do the animation. I would record the animation. I was actually living in Michigan at the time and working with some students at Michigan State on the campus video network. And I borrowed a 3/4-inch tape deck and a video camera, and I would just shoot it right off the monitor. And lo and behold, I'd done my first logo work for a... And in fact, one of my goals was that I wanted to be able to see work I did in my living room. And granted, it was on local cable access, but there it was on my TV in the living room. After that, I got interested in a slightly more sophisticated system. And there's a company called Cubicomp, which actually surprisingly happened to be back in Berkeley, and they had a system which was also a frame buffer. And there was the hardware component to it, but they also had software for doing modeling. And this was basically made as a visualization computer. And it was, now all of a sudden we could create three-dimensional solid objects that were lit by a light, and they had different colors and all of that kind of thing. My interest in animation, again, was... not quite being met by the company, and I actually talked them into hiring me, and I wrote the animation software for this. And this is a demo reel of some of the early Cubicomp stuff that we had done.
Welcome to the world of Cubicomp.
This animation was all recorded with... there was an interface to a 3/4-inch tape deck that was basically commanded to do single frame edits. So we would do, you'd render the image, and then the thing would do pre-roll, do a single frame edit, and these things would take could easily take overnight to spit out.
With a little practice, you'll be producing sophisticated models, slides, and animation such as this.
Apparently, all I needed was a little practice. So now, I'm going to show you a clip from the very first movie I worked on. It was in 1985. It was called Invaders from Mars. And one of the interesting things about the use of computer graphics in feature films was that the computers were definitely not, as you could tell from that demo reel, definitely not sophisticated enough to be doing what's kind of commonplace today with visual effects. But it was good enough to start doing imagery that would play back on a television set in a movie. And so here's an example of a scene from Invaders from Mars.
No, it's a temp freeze. Well, tell Mission Control I'm authorizing. I know, I'll be right down.
Good, Doctor.
So, General, we're going down to control. We'll be back.
Amazing Mission Control, NASA level graphics playing in the movie.
There's an LOX truck on the runway, sir.
In 1985, again, remember, we're looking forward now, not looking back. And it gave the filmmakers an important tool to be able to tell the story from another angle and create some, help the audience understand what was going on and give that guy a chance to really be worried. There you go. My first credit. So You had to start somewhere. While CubaComp was a company that made a product that other people would use to make images, and I kind of realized at the time that I was interested in making the pictures, not the machine that made the pictures. And there's another company in the Bay Area that was doing quite advanced, certainly relatively speaking, computer animation at the time, a company called PDI. And they were down in Sunnyvale, and they were there was a couple of guys that had worked at, I know they'd gone to Stanford, maybe worked at HP. I don't quite remember the background, but and they had a lot of again, it was all kind of inventing as we went, but they were very early in the broadcast animation world, and the computers that they were using were kind of going up the scale of expense here. We used Ridge computers, which were based on an architecture called RISC, Reduced Instruction Set Computer, and the idea being that they're simple, but they could be very fast, and I guess categorically they were called mini computers maybe at the time, not sure. They used a Unix operating system, and we had written, most of the programs for that were written in C, and most of our interaction with them was through scripting. There was very little interactive user interfaces. But we had full color frame buffers. All of a sudden we could render things with beautiful anti-aliasing and not worry about managing our color space. For recording animation, we built literally a little microcontroller. I think it was called a Professor. So anyhow, it was one of these little breadboard chip things that the computer could give a command to, and then that would command the one-inch tape deck to do a single frame edit. These machines were getting to be expensive now. This is $100,000 for one of those. Expensive on our scale. This is, and here's a demo reel of some of the broadcast work that we did at PDI. So I had achieved my first goal of seeing something that I'd done on a TV set in my living room, and I made up my next goal was, okay, I want to have something that's on TV at the same time in on the West Coast as it is in the East Coast, and that gave the impression of some kind of coverage. So this was the opening to, this is one of the first jobs I did. It was the opening to ABC's coverage of Liberty Weekend, and guess what? Live fireworks, West Coast, East Coast. Another thing that was very important in the development of computer graphics at that time was was a ACM SIGGRAPH conference, and it was a place every year that people could get together and share what was going on. And in 1988, I got to do the opening animation to the film and video show using the ubiquitous teapots that came out of Utah, I believe, in the early days of computer graphics. Things were continuing to evolve very quickly, and the Ridge computers were fine for that level of stuff. We started getting involved in a lot more interactive work and much more sophisticated. We kept having to one-up ourselves, and the next kind of phase of hardware that we used were these Silicon Graphics machines. Actually, this is a point where the cost started to turn around, and these were more mass-marketed machines, various levels of hardware specifically geared towards doing computer graphics, interactive interfaces, full-color graphics, all of that kind of thing. Around then, I got a chance to work on my second movie, and this still had the bridge between relatively low-detail computer animation and feature films being through the television set. Particular movie, Scrooged, stars Bill Murray, and he was the head of a imaginary TV station that, of course, needed...
9 o'clock. IBC presents America's favorite family in a special
comedy.
Christmas
You'll
episode.
Hi, Mom.
Where's Dad? Should have been home by now.
Well, Wally, if I know your father, he's out chasing beaver.
Father loves beaver. Here
so there's a logo
IBC
for Bill Murray's fake TV station, and it happens to play back not just on one TV, but 9 TVs. So that's pretty. That was pretty cool. And
oh my gosh!
There you go. So that was, it was such a it was an such a fun experience working on that. And all of a sudden, it was just about, I think it was the idea of just about being entertaining. And this, actually, this relates back to something about the conversation that, you know, the jet contrail simulations and the kind of work that a lot of you guys do and other, you know, other visualizations and I know, you know, astronomical imaging, those kind of things, those are really, they care about the data. That's the first thing. And the picture serves an important purpose, but it can't, you can't color the data too aggressively. For us, we can do anything we want. If whatever it takes to make the picture, it's fair game. So now I had been bit by the Hollywood making movies bug, and I talked the guy who owned PDI or ran PDI into letting us open an office in Hollywood and getting to get involved in doing visual effects on a bigger scale, and I was pretty sure we would have some success at that. To do this, we had to actually still do some invention. This is a little more sophisticated than the cable release that I'd made 10 years earlier, but or 7 years earlier. We could actually get images out of a computer onto film using a film recorder like the ones in the upper left-hand corner. And those were actually the original version of a keynote presentation would be a slideshow that you would print out of your computer and you'd run slides. But we weren't able to get the film images into the computer, and there were no digital scanners at the time, so we built one. And we took a chip that was made to go on a telescope, and it was a 2K by 2K liquid-cooled chip. And we got the movement from an optical printer that would present one frame of film at a time, and then with a light source through a color filter, we would expose three images, the red, green, and blue, and all of a sudden we were able to scan in film, and really closing the loop. And we'd been doing digital compositing for years before this, but at video resolution, and really now, once we had this tool, we could start working on legitimately on visual effects in movies. And here's a little taste of some of the early PDI visual effects that we did. So that was into PDI, and in 1995, that PDI decided that it was headed more towards doing animated features, and Myself and a couple of partners decided that we really wanted to now take these tools to the next level, and we were just kind of coming into our own. And we started a company called Hammerhead Productions in 1995. And here's a sample of our first, I don't know, probably a dozen or so years worth of work. These are little clips from each one of the movies we worked on. One kind of embarrassment of riches is even if you've worked on 100 movies and you only use a second piece from each one of those in a demo reel, it's still almost a couple minutes long. So it's always been a challenge to kind of go back through that. A long ways from Showgirls. That was our first movie. I'm going to show you a little clip from the movie, which really contains kind of a classic Hollywood, amazing chase, unbelievable sequence. And then I'm going to show you a little bit of behind the scenes of what goes into making those various things happen. So here's a clip from Wanted. So there you go. That's that is a scene from Wanted. That scene was planned and actually shot over the course of about a year, and these are some of the early tests and a technique using pre-visualization where we would create really super crude animation, but this helps work out what the angles should be, how long they should be, and just to give the filmmakers a chance to really practice before really getting out there and having to get the pieces that go into making these things together. And this is plenty of information to tell if you're going to have an exciting sequence or not, certainly. So then there's kind of three major categories of work that appeared in that reel. The first of them is green screen. This is very common for driving in a car. One thing that actors are, well, maybe there's a lot of things they're terrible at, but one thing they're really terrible at is driving a car and acting at the same time. It's too many things going on. So it's common to film them in a stage with green screen out the window, and this is a very controlled environment, and everybody can do multiple takes, and the resets are very easy. The director can work over and over again on the acting aspect of what the characters need to be doing, not worrying about driving. When we get that, we replace those green backgrounds with live action, and once sound is added to that, it's convincing that you're in that these characters are hope I didn't spoil anything for anybody, but that's... in fact, surprising, the actors are almost never at the big stunt scenes like that. It's just too complicated schedule-wise and all that. Actually, Angelina was here for a little bit for the hood scenes. They had shot her, and they had a safety harness on her. It's amazing, but it's still dangerous, and nobody wants to, have an accident. So then we would take that footage and we would remove the harness and with a lot less comedic elements. We also snuck the bus a little bit closer. So then the last category is adding CG elements to shots. These are a bunch of the plates that were shot of the stunts, and they're relatively exciting. Certainly if you saw this, you would think that's amazing, but some of them are fairly incomplete. Just this generic aerial shot here. So then when we take that same bunch of shots and we add things, it gets much more exciting, and it's controlled. And of course, you've got to have the sparks to identify the real deal there. So here's this is a little bit more detailed breakdown of one of the shots. This was the bus. These guys could, in the movie, they could apparently somehow by doing something, they could make bullets curve. And that part we left up to the filmmakers to decide how that worked. This is what went into the final composite on this shot. This is the final shot that's in the movie. And that's made up of a scan of original, the bus was there, but of course the lights weren't on, and we added all of these dynamic elements to that. We put cars in various, this was a slow motion scene, so these cars were in various states of crashing into each other, and we needed to fill out the background cars that were in there. Lots of little details, that you labor over and go by in a blink of an eye. And then we spend a lot of time kind of building in camera effects like depth of field and chromatic aberration and things like that to match the photography that we're combining with. And then the car was done as two different elements here that we handed off between, and we had to add the debris of the tire blowing out. So this literally is the finished scene. It's just that little moment there, but it took all of those pieces to make that. This is the last shot in that scene here, and This is the shot that you saw in the reel there where the bumper falls off. The director loved that. He was looking for little comedic touches to be able to put in here. But one of the challenges with this shot was when they photographed this, they didn't know what process the car was going to have gone through to get here. So they literally shot a perfectly pristine Viper. There was no scratches or dents or anything in it. And so we effectively reconstructed the skin of that and adding all of these details, obviously the sparks and the rims and the bumper falling off. We had to create the stuff that was up behind there. And lest you thought we were done, there's even the detail of getting the mirror to dangle off properly here, because that happened in an earlier shot. And so that whole thing comes together to be this. And you can't believe the car even drives, but there it does. So that's a little before and after. One of the things that was another innovation that we did on this is that because this is a sports movie, a modern sports movie, we knew there was going to be a lot of moving cameras and crazy dramatic moments. And one of the things we have to do in visual effects, if we want to create something that looks like it's in the same space as something that you photograph with a camera, we have to be able to track where that camera was very accurately. And one of the way that we do that is usually image-based tracking, and you compare what one frame, where the details of one frame are in the next frame, and you can kind of reverse engineer where the camera had to be to have photographed that. The challenge comes when you're doing close-ups, or there's dust, or there's a lot of motion blur, those kind of things. You can't see enough detail in the image to track that. So we put a GoPro camera on the front of the movie camera, and every time, no matter what the DP or the director was looking for as far as the shot was concerned, we had this great big wide angle, kind of like metadata for what the shot would be, and it was easy to track things that were outside the frame and give us a solution. The other advantage is we got a great making of reel out of it, so this really is. It's kind of a grueling process, it turns out, making a film. It can easily be a few hundred man years worth of work that goes into this. And One thing that films haven't captured, although you can experience a little bit of it by stepping outside of the air-conditioned splendor of this place, is how goddamn hot it was there. It's, especially after it would rain. In California, when it rains, it cools down, but not in Chattanooga. It gets humid and really sticky. So that is 42. Here's another film that we worked on that is not considered by anybody a visual effects film, but in fact it is. There's 100 visual effects shots in this movie. A lot of them are cleanup, little tuning, perfect things, but we had there's a particularly critical moment in this movie that we played a role in, and I'll show you a quick little reel from this.
This is where I live.
Do you want the cancer?
The what?
Do you want the cancer?
The cancer?
The can, sir?
Oh, no, I'm fine, thank you.
You're awfully isolated the way you live.
Isolated? I'm surrounded.
So, your assistant said you were going to be in Vegas.
Did he?
Can you get a photo of the cutout in front of the Luxor Pyramid?
This is a shithole. Nobody stays there.
Jesus, Ryan, I'm not asking you to check in. Can you just take a stupid photo?
I'll try my best.
Thank you for trying your best.
Okay, just walk it in a little more. There you go. Yeah. Got it.
They're a cute couple.
Think so?
Yeah, they're like cute kids.
How do you like Wisconsin in February?
I like it if you're there. And I know Killer Burger in Milwaukee.
Northern Wisconsin. What are you doing this weekend?
No.
Well, I haven't.
No. Well, you want me to be your date?
So I was in the neighborhood.
Hey, honey, who's at the door?
It's just someone who's lost.
little bit of a depressing note, but the very exciting thing about that, from my perspective, this movie actually is a great example of visual storytelling, and literally with a single shot, these guys were able to make this incredibly important point that she wasn't who he thought she was. And the way that they did that is, behind her you see a couple of kids running up the stairs. And this is the original plate from the film as it was photographed, and oh look, there's no kids there. And as it appeared in the movie, there's kids running up. And really, in that one little moment, it was such an important opportunity to do that. here's a reel that has some behind-the-scenes stuff, some more behind-the-scenes stuff from Up in the Air, as well as a handful of other things that Hammerhead did, showing some nice before and afters. It's almost always, you know, filmmakers are very specific about what appears on the screens of these things, and often in the heat of production you can't know that, and it's fairly easy to add that afterwards, cleaning up things like the Luxor Hotel to be more like you imagine it, not like it actually is. There's the shot with the kids. This board, complicated board, didn't exist, and so this is from a film called Book of Eli, which was a post-apocalyptic movie with Denzel Washington. We did a lot of set extensions in this. The one rule from the filmmakers was that there can't be any plants anywhere. Anytime you see a plant, you got to get rid of it. And it's an example of that. A lot of times, filmmaking is really, sometimes you just can't recreate something, and you need to do that somehow with visual effects. There's a lot of times that it's just kind of practically makes sense to do it, like the driving scenes. It's just much more, much easier to control that situation. And as long as it looks like we want it to look in the end, how you get there is, it's really pretty fair game. Obviously, you don't want to shoot Johnny Depp for real, but it helps the movie if it looks like he really got shot, so. Steve Martin wouldn't actually smoke. Who knew? These driving shots are done on a black stage, and adding a little bit of moving lights helped. And Alec Baldwin wasn't quite as, was a little more modest than on set than he was in the movie. Another movie with a Chicago connection. Those are the past, and this, as you'll recognize by the glowing orb, represents the future. And there's a couple of areas that we're starting to take advantage of. One of the, and this is kind of an interesting shot to show it. This is starts with some old NASA footage of I don't know which launch, and we go from there, and this is from the movie Aloha that was with Bradley Cooper, Cameron Crowe directed, and one of the things that's been traditionally incredibly challenging about computer graphics is the amount of time that it takes to render frames, and using traditional software techniques to do that is, you know, people are often willing to wait a few hours per frame to render. And that gets to be very laborious. If you have a shot of a few hundred frames, then all of a sudden you need a lot of machines, basically. And a couple of years ago, there was a company that started taking advantage of some of the R&D that has been happening driven by the video game industry. A company called Redshift makes a fully unbiased rendering system that takes advantage of the multiple GPUs available in NVIDIA cards like the Titan, for instance. So all of a sudden we can be doing unbelievably complex rendering assisted by 6,000 cores in the typical configuration might have two or three of these in a PC. And it's given us 100, literally the same frame will render 100 times as fast as that, and that makes a huge difference. And these are some other shots where we use that in the movie Aloha. And you know, the trick about doing photorealistic rendering is you have to have every little nuance in there, every little bounce of light, every shadow has to be perfect, the depth of field has to match what we're used to seeing, chromatic aberration has to be built into it, and we spend a lot of time kind of mimicking the flaws of reality, as it seems like, but this tool, the Redshift renderer and the GPU accelerated cards give us a real gives a chance to really push that, sometimes to the breaking point. Another area I'm proud to show you a self-portrait of is using motion capture, and this gives us an opportunity to basically, it's an animation technique where you literally act the part and the computer records your motion, and you can apply that to a character. So here's an example of this is kind of a work in progress still, but this is a little scene. This actually is combining my old movies love. This is from the soundtrack comes from a 1968 exploitation film, and we're reimagining the look of it using that.
Bert Dawson, well, you're a sight for sore eyes.
Oh, Theodore.
How about having a little drink in honor of the returning prodigal?
Sure, you know, this is really a big surprise. I heard about that little accident of yours, and I thought you left Africa for good.
No, Africa won't let me off the hook. There's no work for us mercenaries right now. So I thought I'd come to Nairobi for the sake of old times and old friends. What's it doing?
Nothing much.
By the way, have you seen Albert?
No.
Which one was Albert? Oh, yes, I think I remember your mad doctor friend. I haven't seen him for a good many years.
Oh, actually, that's what I was just going to ask you. He was your medico, wasn't he? I thought you boys left Nairobi together.
Yeah, but a while ago, we split up.
Is there anything wrong?
This movie is very melodramatic.
I hope I can locate him. I want to see him about this.
So this series is going to be a bunch of little cliffhangers like that, and to do this, we literally can make those episodes in, you know, on the order of a week or so, and using that kind of rendering and that amount of animation, it's a new world, and these days actually films and TV aren't the only option anymore. There's the whole internet out there, and it's incredibly hungry for programming. I think there's something like 400 series are currently in production, and it's just a big appetite for creating entertainment. The really next step that I'm kind of excited about is this whole idea of augmented reality. I'm not sure why I made it so tiny there, but this is the last thing that I have to show, and I actually have a live demo of this running on an iPad, but... So augmented reality gives you an opportunity to impose computer-generated objects or elements on a live-action into a live-action environment, and so we're playing with the idea of being able to. This is actually something that I've always been trying to figure out how to do is how do you get stuff out of the computer? And you know, sure, there's 3D printing, kind of recently. That's great, but this is a way to give the illusion that really. I shot that right here, so. And we can bring Mitch Hedberg back to life. So there you go. That's what I have. This is a fabulous quote that I came up with in the middle of some particularly stressful thing. The filmmakers kept saying, well, you can fix that, right? You can do that. And it's like, look, guys, I can do anything. I just can't do everything. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm sure that all of you have a ton of questions, maybe a couple from the public.
So I have two related questions. So first is, cinematography has been very essential part of narration of the movie for, and great directors themselves have been cinematographers initially. And they change the narration. So how much do you think that the visualization that you do you have changed the narration or the way they wanted to portray something, like some instances?
There's a couple of interesting things that happened in the visual storytelling of movies. There was a noticeable change that happened in the, it was kind of in the early 90s, mid 90s, when people started being able to edit a film digitally. But before digital editing, they literally cut with a piece of film, and the word cutting was from a razor blade that would slice the film. And on that movie that I worked on, Toys, that had Robin Williams in it with the skeletons, that kind of thing, I remember sitting with the editor one time, and we were trying to figure this scene out, and I said, well, how long do you think that shot should be? And he pulled a piece of film out, and he went, I think it should be about this long. And I was like, oh my God, you're right. It's the length of, I mean, it's, and in fact, filmmakers still, old editor, you know, old school editors still talk about dissolves being like a 2-foot dissolve, that kind of a thing. So that changed the visual storytelling a lot. The other thing that, and visual effects has a huge part of this, and it's to me, it's a little bit of a scary answer, but. I remember that this happened to me on the first Jurassic Park movie. There was a scene in that the dinosaur is biting the tire of a car and it popped at the perfect time. And when I saw the movie, I thought, oh my God, they did a great job of combining those two pieces together. And it turns out that not only, I mean, clearly the dinosaur was CG, so was the damn car. And it's like, oh my God, they figured out how to do that. The step that caused for me was that all of a sudden, we used to make movies because we could. It's like, oh, we got this cool thing, like the morphing faces in the Michael Jackson video. We got this cool thing. Here, you figure out a way to use it. But now, all of a sudden, you can do anything. It makes it hard because you got to think of something worth doing. And, I mean, I think actually, there was a movie that came out this year that is like, you know, drop the mic for me. It was the Jungle Book. That entire movie, as realistic as it looks, as emotionally compelling, not, the kid was shot as a live-action element. Everything else in that movie was synthetic. They had some hella render times, too. They had 40-hour frames on that. And I was talking to the supervisor after, right after they finished that, and he said, if the movie was 96 minutes, we wouldn't have finished it. It was 95. So I don't know if that answers your question, but...
The other thing, if you would like to tell something about, so a lot of new movies, especially I'm talking about the Interstellar, in which people have talked to Kip Thorne, like physicist, and he included many realistic simulations into the movie, and also the movie Gravity, in which they right. simulated the free gravity, like very. How much do you think is coming more?
There's a couple of schools of thought on this. One is to be very realistic and to adhere to that kind of thing. I worked on a movie I worked on a movie called Supernova. This was back in the late 90s. And this was a story about a ship that was trapped, that kind of jumped out into a star system that was going supernova that they hadn't realized. And we wanted to create some very dramatic visuals for when that was. And so we hired, I just could remember her name a second ago. I can't remember it now. Anyhow, we had a science advisor from JPL to help us make sure that we got it right. And so we said, we don't want to just have this be like an orange ball like or a yellow star like the sun. Can we make it a blue, you know, one of these kind of raging blue supergiant stars? And she said that, yeah, absolutely, why not? It could be any one of those. And so what would it look like? And she said, well, the reality is if you had a blue supergiant, you would have to be at the orbit of Pluto to not get cooked by it. And guess what the blue supergiant looks like if you're at the orbit of Pluto? It looks like our sun does to us. We made it huge. So so we knew what we found out what we were supposed to do, and it didn't quite fit what we wanted, so.
That's good. Thank you.
Yeah. I guess. Oh.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I found it very amazing. I was wondering, have you ever been stuck technologically or because of a movie maker was asking you something that was not feasible or hardly feasible? Or do you have a story about this?
We have prided ourselves at being very careful about not promising things that we didn't think we could accomplish. I do have a little bit of a funny story. I worked on Titanic. And there was a shot, there was a scene, I'm sorry I don't have a clip of it here, but there was a scene where it was the Jim Cameron described it as the last happy moment of the Titanic, where they're going out and Leonardo and the other guy are standing on the front and they see a pod of dolphins down in the water. And the guy says, oh, I can see the Statue of Liberty, it's very small. And they shot some dolphins, some footage of dolphins, but they weren't kind of exciting enough, and so Jim wanted to add a bunch of dolphins to this scene so that they would be more playful and more happy and all of that kind of thing. And this was in 90, Titanic was 90 something, early, late
90s. 98,
no? 96, 90, anyhow. It was still, we were nervous about doing it. We were really nervous about doing computer-generated dolphins in a movie, especially for a guy like Jim Cameron. And I did that. One of the shots literally had completely fake dolphins in it, and kind of going under the thing. And I got it to look the best I possibly could, and I sent it over to Jim. And I was like, oh God, I hope he likes it. And the note came back, it looks fake. And I'm like, oh my God, what? I don't know. How am I going to recover from that? But then I read further down, and it's like, this doesn't look like the Titanic at all. And he didn't care about the dolphins. He cared about the ship. And I was like, oh my God, thank God. I can make the boat look fabulous, no question. So, it's tricky. You have to, one of the things I remember doing on the Michael Jackson morphing faces, that premiered to an audience of 500 million people. When that came out in 91, 2, something like that, 500 million people were watching it. And that is a lot of motivation to get it right. And we knew that once we were done with it, it was going to be out there and we weren't ever getting it back. So there was a lot of hard work kind of figuring it out. And again, looking back, it seems easy in retrospect. But moving forward, it was kind of like, so. I think you had a question over here. Or?
It's a pretty short question, actually. How do the effects artists know when they're done? Like, for example, with
that's an amazing question, actually. It's funny that you asked that because I had in the very early days, and it turns out I've never had a chance to work with him, but I had a dream that I was doing something for Steven Spielberg, and I asked him that same question. I said, how do I know when I'm done? And he said, you're done when I say you're done. So I'm sure he's a nice guy, but it's funny because it's a business, obviously. We're and it gets to be very, you know, very tricky. But there's all of these there's a lot of expectations about the level of accomplishment and all of that kind of thing. And I think this also relates to one of the things that was always confusing to me in the beginning, was it's like people always said you to get a job in Hollywood, you have to know somebody. And we actually didn't quite have to know somebody when we started doing work, because we had such a cool tool. If you wanted a wire removal of Arnold's motorcycle jumping into a thing, we were the only guys that could do that, literally. And so we had a little bit of a pass, and instead of being who we knew, it turned into what we could do. And so we were careful in those early days not to promise stuff that we couldn't do. And then I've started to understand the who you know part of it, and that is that, there's some very stressful things. There's a lot of money, there's release dates, there's all of this stuff kind of riding on it. And if I've worked with you before and you say it's going to be fine, then okay, great, I get it. If I don't know, if I haven't ever, so a lot of it has to do with that, and you know, we just have to be, you have to be careful. This, I mean, just everybody has that, where deadlines and you have to meet those. And I have another funny little saying, and that especially in visual effects, you know, we're kind of in the background. We don't really we're not called on that, you know, put on the spot that often. But I always say that every once in a while, the spotlight turns and hits you. And when it does, this is a Hollywood thing. When the spotlight hits you, you have to sing the note. And so here I see the spotlight here. Hopefully I sang the note for you guys.